Last week, the Philippine Coast Guard released a video of a China Coast Guard supposedly preventing the medical evacuation of a sick Philippine Navy personnel stationed in BRP Sierra Madre in Ayungin Shoal, right? So, in effect, the Philippine Coast Guard says that the Chinese Coast Guard had blocking operations, which made it very difficult to actually move the sick Philippine Navy personnel. The description was harassed by vessels and small boats. So, ang tanong lang naman ganito eh, araw-araw na ganito? Diba ganun yun eh, Professor? Diba yan ang tanong? Araw-araw na tayo bang ganito? O sige, maninindigan tayo, pero araw-araw ganito kahirap? Diba? Parang ang tanong natin, ilang taon ba to? Ilang taon to na pag nag-resupply ka sa Ayungin Shoal, hihintuin ka? Ilang taon ba to na kapag nag-resupply ka, i-water cannon ka? Because it's a given, we are standing up for it. Well, unless the president, the next president, doesn't do the same thing, right? Because we have to remember, this president has taken a different and more confrontational approach to standing up for the tribunal victory. But who knows with the next president? I mean, all China is waiting for is, let's just wait 6 years. After President Marcos Jr., the next president may not have the same policy as him. That's the problem.
Yes, it is the problem. And yes, araw-araw magiging ganyan, because that is exactly China's intention to make it so difficult for us that we voluntarily give up and withdraw. Now, the problem with that, of course, is that, yeah, you might have some peace and quiet for a short time, but they're not going to stop there. No. You give them an inch, they'll take the whole arm. Basically, that will be the start of us losing all of our rights and entitlements to the West Philippine Sea. And that will also be the start of us being subordinated to China and Chinese power in the region.
Yeah.
So it's for the people to decide now. Is that what they want to happen?
No, I don't think that's debatable, Professor. We're not there anymore. Mm-hmm. The Philippines, if you do a survey, the Filipino people want to stand up for the West Philippine Sea. Ang tanong nga lang is, kung araw-araw ito, should we do something out of the box? For example, when we resupply in Ayungin Shoal, should we do a test resupply mission where we have Australia assisting us, the U.S. assisting us, just to check if China would behave the same way? Right?
Yes, actually. And I do think that certain options, shall we say, of course, we can't really reveal all that, but certain options have been considered already. And in a way, we are testing the waters then. No? I would say that, yes, we need to do something else other than just facing the same interference every day. No? Well, adversity breeds ingenuity, as people like to say. No? So I think that at some point we might see that happening, but of course we have to be prepared for the for that event. No, everything has to be prepared, because definitely the other side will not react kindly to what we do.
Mm. So I wanted to ask you. Former Senior Associate Justice Antonio Carpio said the litmus test for President Marcos Jr. is to already start exploration of the reed bank. Malaysia started it. We are not yet starting this. There was a moratorium during the time of former President Duterte. Ang tanong, will it make a difference? What message will it send if President Marcos Jr. says we're starting to explore the reed bank?
Well, I think that that would definitely show the determination of the country to assert and exercise its rights in the West Philippine Sea, and to really completely ignore this outrageous nine-dash-line claim. Mm. So yes, it will be a litmus test of that intention. Reed Bank, after all, is a submerged feature. This is open sea, open water, and it's not something that China can legitimately claim any rights over at this point, given the South China Sea arbitration. No? So if they try to stop us there, then clearly it is going to be another unilateral imposition only of Chinese law in an area which is the Philippines, belongs to the Philippines under international law, meaning the resources there belong to the Philippines under international law. So they cannot possibly justify interference there before the international community, and it will only isolate them and alienate them even more, I think. And right now, given their situation, I think that their the margin for tolerating even more distrust from the international community is already very small.
Okay. Now, Professor, who is to tell China you cannot impose that law that is illegal in international waters? Who is to say that to China? The Philippines went to ITLOS, right? For the UNCLOS, we want that, but they have no police powers. But when it comes to China, actually, it's not actually just a declaration to us. It is all of ASEAN, right? It's all of ASEAN, not just the Philippines. But who's to tell China? You cannot make a unilateral law.
Ultimately, it's the international community as a whole, no, that can do that. And that's why we continue to build up our relations with all these other countries. And that's why we're also seeing, year by year, an increasing number of countries calling out
excuse me,
and pointing to the South China Sea Arbitration and UNCLOS as the prevailing law. No? Admittedly, because China is being obstinate, it will take a long time. It might take decades. No, but I think that's really the only way. In the international community, which is, you know, it's unlike an ordinary community where there is a sovereign. No, everybody in the international community is equal. So in that sense, it's the community itself as a whole. That's the only one that can really enforce its own rules. No, and it doesn't necessarily have to be through coercion or use of the coercive tactics like a police or a sheriff. It will have to be by making China realize that it's costing it more to be an outlaw, to be an outcast. No, it's making its life even more difficult. No, by doing that. No, and eventually it has to realize that it should play by the same rules as everyone else, and there, it should not be a system where one country will lord it over all.
Okay, my last question is: are you giving hope on the ASEAN? I mean, the EU may not be a perfect body, but at the end of the day, for example, the EU has backed Ukraine on territorial issues. You have, I think, one that's abstained, or some nations abstaining from that. But they take a point of view. They take a stand. With ASEAN, we've been silent when it comes to the West Philippine Sea. The code of conduct, we've been waiting for that for so long. Some have said at this point, forget that, that would be a trap. But at the end of the day, you have ASEAN that has not given a point of view on the West Philippine Sea. Instead, you have ASEAN asking the Philippines not to have foreign intervention with this issue.
Well, I think that ASEAN, no, has its particular purposes. Particular uses, no. After all, it was designed in a different time for a very specific purpose of promoting economic relations between such a disparate set of peoples. When it comes to political security issues like this, no, unfortunately, it's not the the appropriate body. And as ASEAN gets even larger, we've seen that its ability to make decisions on these kinds of issues is becoming even weaker. So I'm not holding out that much hope at this time. No? ASEAN has to mature still, no, on this. That means we have to still keep on working on building up unity within ASEAN first, engage in the community building. That being said, that means that there is some possibility for less than ASEAN, meaning within ASEAN members, like claimants only. I think that's the one that we need to explore. After all, we saw the unity of the ASEAN claimants back in 1992 when they came up with the declaration. No, it got a little weaker by the 2002 declaration. No, but there's still some hope there. Especially now that we see that China's increasing aggressiveness in expansion, no?
Yeah.
It will reach a point where even these other countries that have been sort of on the fence, they will realize that the longer term trend here is that after the Philippines, they will be next.
Okay. And just to go back to China's influence, what's happening on the other side of the world? I want to ask you if there's a similarity to it. Not exactly, but we know that Ukraine President Zelensky was in the Philippines, and he was talking to President Marcos Jr. about the peace summit. So just recently, EU countries voted, right? I mean, there were several countries that voted to on the proposed summit, right? And two countries didn't vote. And they were very crucial countries, Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates. They chose not to back the document. And while Russia wasn't invited to that gathering, what's interesting is China, who said to be the main backer of Russia's war economy, didn't attend to and essentially supports it. So at the end of the day, you have China influence on that side of the world and China influence on this side of the world, and also China influence on the African side of the world. So the question is there a similarity with a fact when very powerful nations, because in that side of the world, it was Saudi Arabia and the UAE, who did not vote for that peace summit document, right? One would think, who wouldn't vote for such a document? But they didn't. And is it the same with our problem here? Do yes, we it's, have it's... powerful ASEAN countries who could tip the scale, and yet they're choosing to be silent on China's aggressive behaviors in the South China Sea?
Yes, it's a very similar situation. You still have the power play and the horse trading, etc., between the powerful countries among the small. No? And the key there is for the smaller countries, the middle powers, so to speak, no? To be able to seek the leverage, to find that, find the lever, the proper levers, to find the proper balancing between the smaller countries so that they can generate more resistance, or they could mobilize the support. No? And I think that's the task before us now. The thing is, people have to understand that this is not, you know, this is not instant decision making. There are many factors at play, and we have to be really careful and strategic in what we do and who we get to support us. And we have to be patient. No? People keep looking for instant solutions. There is none, because this is an international community. These are world politics at play. And so you can't just expect things to change overnight. No? So we have to be the ones to do it. We do have some powerful friends. No? It's not just the U.S., but there are several others, no, that could play that part of also joining us and tipping the balance with respect to certain countries. The thing there is that we have to be really conscious and deliberate in planning that out. No? It could take years, essentially. But we have to do it. No? There's no other way. Otherwise, we'll just have to give up kung ganon and allow ourselves to be carried away by the decisions of other nations. No? So we just have to keep on doing it.
On that note, thank you so much, Professor J. Batung Bangkal, for joining me today. Thank you, sir.
Welcome, Karen. Welcome. And thank you also.